And please make extremely welcome Miss Sarah McKenzie.
We're here tonight at Bennetts Lane Jazz Club in Melbourne with Sarah McKenzie. Sarah, you've been living in America the last 6 months. Welcome back to Australia.
Thank you very much.
And can you tell us a little bit about how it's been living in America and studying at Berkeley?
It's been incredible. It's been a wonderful experience, which I'm so eager to get back to. Incredibly different from Melbourne. I must say I had a little bit of a culture shock when I first got there. I went into Starbucks and tried to order a skim, no fat latte. And I was asked, do you want extra cream with that? So, it takes a little bit of adjusting to get used to, but America is incredible. Incredibly diverse, that's one of its strong points. Because of Berkeley, I have met some of the most incredibly talented musicians from all around the world, from El Salvador to Puerto Rico to Italy and Spain, and I work with all these incredibly talented musicians. Berkeley, the music school, is amazing. The teachers there are world class. I'm having an absolute ball studying there and I can't wait to learn more.
So Sarah, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your musical journey?
Well, I started playing piano when I was 5 and I had classical lessons for a while, and I was a very bad student and I really wanted to give up the piano immediately because I just found it all a bit too much. I just couldn't get the hang of scales and studies, and to be honest, there seemed to me at my tender age of 7 to be, to have the scales to have not a great deal of purpose. Like, what is the point of them? It's not until now that I realise how important they are. But at that point in my time, I needed a different approach. And I'm really blessed that I had a father that believed in my musical potential. So he went out and found me a rock and roll and blues piano teacher. And that was incredible. And he played the blues, and for some reason, the blues really resonated with my soul. And I just wanted to play like him. That started an incredible musical journey for me, which I'm still on, and I hope to still be on for my entire life. From there I got involved in jazz and I fell in love with Oscar Peterson and Bill Evans and Keith Jarrett. I went to the James Morrison Scholarship, was lucky enough to be a finalist in his competition, and that opened me up to wonderful mentoring possibilities with James and with Graham Lyle, some of Australia's most notable musicians. So it's been a wonderful journey. That's where I started, and now I'm in America studying the music that I'm most passionate about, with the vision of becoming a great recording artist, putting some really great music into the world. But it's not where you start, it's where you end up. So where I end up, I do not know, but I don't care, it's an adventure.
Sarah, last year you won the 2012 Jazz ARIA Award for your latest album, Close Your Eyes. Can you tell us a little bit about the making of the album and the creative process?
Definitely. Well, Close Your Eyes was a really exciting project and album for me, because recording my first album, Don't Tempt Me, was really a combination of everything I had learnt, from the age of 7 up until that album, which we recorded when I think I was about 21. I learnt so much from that first album, from the way that I sing, from the way that I play piano, from the way that I arrange tunes. Hearing it back in that intimate environment with the recording, sometimes it's hard for us to see ourselves until you see yourself under the microscope like that. Oh my gosh, Sarah, you're so flat, you've got to really work on, centering that note. And oh my gosh, Sarah, I don't realise that, that lick you think is amazing actually sounds really average, so, okay, that's okay, don't beat yourself up about it, let's go back and now let's try and, let's try and get it better. So Close Your Eyes, for me, was a huge leap from the first album. Maybe no one else sees it, I don't care, whatever. For me, it was a great progression. I think it shows, individually, a much more mature vocal performance, and a mature piano performance. There's a lot more, you know, that I do. In saying that though, I found I had a whole new range of problems that came up with my playing, so you know, I'm looking forward to the next album. From a group point of view, it was a wonderful experience. I felt like the band that I put together, I always strive to put together the best musicians I possibly can. So, you know, I had to have the best, so I had to have Hugh Stuckey on guitar, and I had to have Craig Simon on the drums, and Alex Bonham from Sydney on the bass. And I felt like we worked really well this time. You know, we had the first album to, you know, kind of suss each other out, but the second album, we worked like a team. And I think that really shows on songs like Big Yellow Taxi. I think that's really unique, that song. I think that's one of the songs I'm most proud of, and a direction that I want to continue in, more of that sound. So, I mean, I could rave on forever about the album, but generally, the things that I take from it that are positive and that I'm most proud of, individually, I felt like I'd progressed and as a musician, and that we worked great as a team, and with Chong as our producer, you know, it was just a wonderful experience.
And how did you feel when you found out that you'd taken out the ARIA for the album?
Funnily enough, when I left Australia, I actually got rid of my iPhone and my phone number, so no one could call me because I really wanted to focus on studying. I got a little prepaid phone, which I gave to my family and to the ABC, but actually it had been flat for 3 days, and I switched it on, and all of a sudden I get this message from a number I'm not familiar with saying, "Congratulations, you've won." I'm like, what have I won? Telemarketers? What? Oh, this is ridiculous. You know, they're contacting me here in America. Can you believe this? You know, I was just at home with my housemate. And then it dawned on me, I was like, what's the date? And I ran to the internet and I got on the email, and then sure enough, there was a message from the ABC and from Chong. Congratulations, you've won the ARIA for best album, for best jazz album for 2012. And oh my goodness, you know, blown away, because we worked really hard on that album. I'm really proud of that album, so it is a fantastic achievement.
So for the album, you recorded it using the latest Yamaha CFX concert grand piano. It was the first one that came to Australia. Can you tell us a bit about how you found playing that piano?
I'm incredibly fortunate and privileged to be able to play on Yamaha pianos. And to play on the CFX actually was a real treat. Because for songs like Big Yellow Taxi and for I Should Care, in particular for me, for the ballads, it really shone. Just the depth of expression that I could get out of the piano for those ballads was magic. So, oh my goodness, it was an incredible privilege for me to be able to play on the CFX piano.
The show tonight at Bennetts, you're playing on a C7.
Yes.
As a pianist, you don't get to carry your own instrument around with you to gigs. How do you feel when you come to a gig and you know there's a Yamaha piano waiting for you?
As you were saying, you know, saxophone players get to take their instruments everywhere they go, and bass players get to take their instruments everywhere they go. You know, they practice on these instruments, and then when they come to perform, they can rely on their instruments. As a pianist, you can't always do that because you don't know what instrument you're going to get. Sometimes you're going to get a piano in a pub that's missing a few notes or something like that. But I think it's incredibly special to know that if there's a Yamaha at the gig, I can relax and I can perform at my best. So I'm incredibly privileged to be able to play on Yamaha pianos.
Okay, Sarah, before we wind up, can I just ask if you've got any advice to offer to young pianists who are perhaps starting on their musical journey?
Well, we are all aspiring musicians, and I'm an aspiring musician. And actually, one of the most inspiring things I've found from going to Berkeley is that my teachers, who are, you know, some of them are 76, are aspiring musicians. And I guess if there's any advice I give to anyone, I give to myself, is to always to continue to aspire to be a great musician, to never stop, to persevere and keep going, you know, because sometimes it gets tough. And sometimes I think you think, if I can just get to this level, then I'll be fine, it'll be fine. No, you should always be searching something new, you know, trying to make it better, trying to search for the beauty in life, you know. So I'd say to keep searching, you know, as a musician.
Thanks a lot for your time today, Sarah.
Thank you very much.
Have a great gig tonight.
Yes.
Best of luck with the rest of your studies.
Thank you very much.